what it is that they're supposed to be focused on. So instead of thinking about your work, you may be thinking about, you know, did I get enough school supplies for my child? Will my internet connection be good today? And so we will be thinking about other things instead of what we're supposed to be focusing on. Also, stress can cause a lot of health problems for our bodies. We could see that over a long period of time where we've experienced stress, our blood pressure can go up. Our maybe our sugar levels, you know, if you have issues with sugar, keeping your sugar in control, that might also be affected. Worsening of mental health conditions, you know, if you suffer from depression or anxiety, stress can make those types of things worse. And also it can increase tobacco and or alcohol. So those are big indicators that stress is taking a toll on us. So firstly, before we address a problem, we have to identify what the problem is. And so this is just a few little questions, you know, that you can ask yourself about, you know, what exactly is going on. So firstly, you would kind of think about, you know, when you start to feel it, and we feel stress in our bodies, we feel it, you know, our bodies might be tense, we might feel it in our shoulders, in our back, you know, in our head. A lot of people report migraine headaches or just these tension headaches that won't go away despite taking, you know, an over-the-counter medication. So we need to identify what exactly is causing you to feel stress. And once you know that, then think, okay, how long has this been affecting me for? When do you feel it the most? Is it, you know, at the beginning of the month, maybe trying to get all the bills paid? Is it at the end of the month when, you know, I didn't do this. I was supposed to meet all these goals and I didn't do them. And so now I'm really stressed out because I have to meet all these goals. And then we have to, the next part would be to discuss, you know, what is our plan to cope with stress? Because if we don't have a plan, stress will consume us and it will become a bigger problem for us if we don't have a plan and a way to handle the stress. So stress will always be in our lives in one form or another. Right now, as we're preparing our children to go back to school, there can be a lot of stress about, you know, all the different ways of helping our children and trying to keep our own life in balance and our own life in check with pandemic and with everything. So we have to have a plan as to how we're going to handle and manage stress in our lives, because it will be there. It is a part of our life. So we're going to go through some strategies that can be utilized to help you manage stress. So firstly, before anything else, we need to take care of our bodies. Okay, so that is the number one way that we can take care of stress. Eat healthy foods and drink plenty of water. So when you're talking healthy foods, I put a little image there of some vegetables and fruits. We should always strive to have vegetables and fruits in our diet because they're natural along with balance. Okay, so we don't want to, you know, have 7 or 8 bananas in a meal because that's not balanced. But, you know, following a good diet and also drinking plenty of water throughout the day. And of course, you know, that's going to keep our bodies replenished. Studies have shown that even just a small amount of dehydration will impact the way your brain works. So we need to stay hydrated, especially in our area, because it is very, very hot where we live. And if we're outside, we sweat a lot more. And so we need to stay very hydrated. Another way to take care of our body is to enjoy nature and get plenty of sleep. And remember, we mentioned that stress affects our sleep patterns. So we have to find a way to, you know, stay asleep at night. And so sometimes having a routine before we go to bed, maybe reading a book or, you know, reciting a poem or something would help. And that's completely up to each individual person. Also, avoid excessive alcohol and prescription drug use. And a lot of times what happens, individuals When they are feeling stressed and maybe they're not sleeping well, they have medications that maybe doctor prescribes and says, take these, you know, whenever you feel the symptoms of this XYZ condition. Well, but they'll make you drowsy, so you can't take them all the time. Well, sometimes people will revert to doing that because they want to sleep better, so they'll take those types of medications that shouldn't be used in that nature. So please, you know, make sure that you're following doctor's orders and taking care of your body in that way. The number one way to reduce stress is to exercise. And I know that exercise has a very, very hard relationship with a lot of us, because how do we squeeze in time to exercise? How do we squeeze in time to work out every day? And really, we just have to plan for it. Now, I know that it's difficult because some people only imagine one form of exercise. And I've always shared with people that you have to really do what you like to do. So if you are not a runner, then running is not your best way to get exercise. If you would rather, you know, play with your children outside, maybe throw the football or, you know, play soccer or maybe do those types of things, you can do that. It's not necessarily that you have to be running 5 miles a day to be exercising. I know right now gyms are open, but there are a lot of restrictions around that. But we need to be creative and find other ways to still get exercise. That way we can still continue to take care of our body. Sometimes individuals are gardening or, you know, doing that type of work that also isn't a workout for you, you know, pulling weeds and things like that, taking care of the yard, that is a workout in and of itself. So, you know, encouraging that, and that would also give you time out in nature and allow you the opportunity to, you know, develop something at your home and get a sense of pride for what you have created. So let's move along here. Another healthy way to cope is to connect with other people. Build a social support network, call a friend, send an e-card, send a text message, a note, strengthen the relationships that you do have, and check on the people that are dear to you. For sure, I know that we are social distancing. We are physically distancing, but not socially distancing. So, you know, we want to make sure that we always stay connected with people. Maybe not physically, but we can always do it. We have so many avenues for technology that we can utilize, and we can FaceTime, we can Snapchat, we can do many, many things. So we can utilize all of that to strengthen ourselves. And, you know, just sometimes talking to a friend and checking in on them and all of that really does a number for our own well-being, because we are connecting, you know, we want those relationships with people. One of the biggest things is always making time to unwind, okay? Making time. We live in a very, very busy society. Everything is busy. Everything is go faster. Everything is do more. And very little is done to stop and relax and rest. So we have to make time to unwind. If it's 10 minutes at night, if it's 20 minutes in the morning before we get going, you know, we need to find a way to do that and a time and set aside and, you know, ensure that we're offering ourselves the opportunity to relax and to unwind. And always, you know, reach out if you need help. I know that most of us, we have family members that are, you know, really close by and, you know, they are part of, you know, our inner circle. And, you know, you can just say, reach out to them and say, I really need some help doing this today. You know, would you be able to help me out? So right now I'm going to lean it over to Ms. Rubio and check in with her and see if we have any questions before we proceed on.
Mrs. Sanchez, at the moment, we do not have any questions. We just have a lot of great comments. So thank you on doing a great job.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all for that. Let's continue on. So additionally, healthy ways to cope, take care of your emotional health. Emotional health is so important, and sometimes we don't even realize the value of our own emotional well-being until it's not so great. And then we realize, uh-oh, you know, some things are not right here. You know, I'm cranky, I'm irritable, nobody likes me right now because I'm in a bad mood. So sometimes we just need to just take a break and step back. So one of the biggest things that individuals can do is take a break from the news. The news, we have, you know, evolved in our news ability. So years ago, we could only watch the news at 6 a.m, at noon, at, you know, 6 o'clock in the evening and 10 o'clock in the evening. That was our routine. However, now we have news at our fingertips 24/7. Your phone can go off at 8:30, at 10:30, at 11, at all hours of the day and even at night. And that's overwhelming for us because that is a lot of information, and it's information overload for our brain because our brain is you know, trying to do all these things, and yet we're just hearing the news over and over. And the news typically is not reporting good things. We're hearing a lot of, you know, there's a lot of problems and a lot of difficult situations that are in our world. So if we just turn that off for a little bit, sometimes that helps us to clear our mind, and that helps us to just relax a little bit. So, you know, maybe turning off the news a little bit on your phone, maybe not getting so many alerts, or maybe having conversations with friends who love to send updates on a regular basis. We all have those kinds of friends who will send, look at this news, look at this news, look at this news. Maybe asking those friends, could you just, you know, tone that down a little bit for me, because that's too much. I can't handle that much news. And, you know, just trying to figure that out. What is the limit that you can have for hearing the news? And then also another thing, laughter is the best medicine. We've seen that, we've heard that. It is really true. Laughter is wonderful for our own emotional health and well-being. And, you know, I inserted a picture there of a couple watching something on the phone and both laughing about it, because that can do a number. Sit down and find a funny comedian or a YouTube video, something of that nature that will help you relax and help you laugh. Myself personally, I am a dog person, so I love dog shaming. And so I have included a couple of pictures, pets that make our day. You know, I find these on the internet. I shared them when I was a school counselor with my students, and they loved it, and we would all laugh and talk about it. And so the dog on the left, if you look, it says, I locked mom out of her car so I could eat all of the Chinese food and half of the pizza, and she had to call a locksmith. And if you have a pet, or you've ever had a pet, you can empathize with these owners. And so that kind of connects us also. This other little picture of this little guy, it says, I steal cookies from little kids in strollers and run away. So those are some funny things that I found, you know, that we can utilize. And this one is probably my all-time favorite image. You know, my house was under attack by a new $700 Roomba, but I saved us. And so, you know, looking at this, it makes us giggle, it makes us laugh. And, you know, that's just something we can do. Sometimes we just need a laugh, we need a break, and that can help us out. So we're moving on to a technique that I'm going to show you how you can do at home. And this is mindful breathing. This is deep breathing, diaphragmatic breathing. It has several names. It's proven that doing this type of breathing helps you focus. It helps you concentrate because you are providing a lot of oxygen all throughout your body. So I'm going to show you how to do this. So first, what you need to do is you need to sit up straight in your chair, no slouching, because when you slouch, your lungs are not as straight as they could be. So sit up straight in your chair, feet as flat as they can be on the floor. If your feet don't hit the floor, just don't cross them. And then put your hands on your lap. And I prefer that people close their eyes, but I understand that that might be difficult for some individuals. So if you don't want to close your eyes, you don't have to. But I always, you know, say to close your eyes because it sort of blocks out everything that you see and it keeps you focused even more. So if you close your eyes, and then just as you would breathe and do this exercise, you're going to breathe in only through your nose and out through your nose. Try not to use your mouth, use your nose. And you're going to breathe in for four counts. And then as you breathe in for four counts, you're going to hold it for four, and then you would release for four. And the purpose of doing all this in a very methodical way is to help you train your body in how to take these deeper breaths. Okay, so we'll try it together. So everybody take a deep breath in through your nose and hold it, and then we'll release it. So ready? Here we go. That's just one. So we would do it several times. So we can try that again. This time, as you breathe in and you hold and you release, try to really just concentrate on your breathing. Don't listen to any sounds around you. Don't think about anything else around you. Just focus on your breathing. Okay, so let's try that again. And that's as easy as it is. It's not anything that is extremely difficult or hard to do. However, I do understand that some of the folks in the audience may have young children, which that may make it difficult to do these types of exercises because young children have a lot of energy and they have it all the time. And so another strategy that I have for you is to just get some bubbles, whatever bubble brand that you have. And this is a really good way to practice deep breathing, and you can integrate it with your children as well. So you would just get the bubble wand out, and you would just do the same thing. You would breathe in. And as you would release, you'd be blowing the bubbles out. Children go crazy for bubbles, and you can have even incorporate a game utilizing this. So you would be doing this, practicing your deep breathing. Oh, there came a bubble. And your children could also be practicing deep breathing. So this is a wonderful, wonderful, easy, not too difficult. You can find bubbles at the dollar store, anywhere. And so I always would recommend, you know, if you have small children who might interfere with your deep breathing time, get a bottle of bubbles and maybe take them outside. Everybody have their bubble time, and it helps your children as well to practice the deep breathing. As like I mentioned, as a school counselor, I would utilize a lot of the deep breathing before we would get started with heavy conversations, and it would help just stabilize so much of the mood for the children. And so I know that it works because I've done it. And so that's another technique that you can utilize to help yourself relax. So moving along, another way to take care of your own emotional wellness is to brighten your outlook. And as I mentioned before about the news is very difficult to watch sometimes. There's a lot of negative press. There's just a lot going on. And so we can see things over and over. So if we find ways, you know, to brighten our outlook, start the day positively. So, you know, if it's going to be a Monday and you know Mondays are rough days, maybe on Sunday night, write yourself a little positive note. You got this. You can do this. The sky's the limit. There's tons of positive quotes that you can put on your mirror in the morning. Or maybe you need to see it in your car when you're going through rough traffic to get to drop off your children or whatever the case may be. You know, you can leave notes for yourself. That way you'd see it and you'd be reminded of it. Also, focus on the good, okay? And that can be very difficult. That can be very challenging because our brains, for whatever reason, are somewhat wired to view a lot of the negativity more. There's actually MRI studies of brains that are more activated when there's negative things going on than when there's positive things. And so we need to focus on the good things, focus on the positive. And also forgive yourself. You know, we all want the best for our children, and sometimes we fail. Sometimes we, you know, we forget things. You know, mom, you said you were gonna do this. Dad, you said you were gonna do this. And, you know, we forget, you know, how to forgive ourselves. And sometimes we just need to say, sorry, you know, I did forget. I'm human. Mommy has a lot on her mind. Dad has a lot on his mind, you know, and so forgive ourselves too for when we do make mistakes with our children or, you know, in work, forgive ourselves and pick ourselves up and move on from that mistake. Also spend more quality time with family. I noticed that sometimes we confuse quantity with quality. So if you spend 5 hours, but everybody's on their cell phone, would that really be quality time? I'm not so sure. However, if we spent, 1 hour where we're having these deep conversations, or we're talking and we're laughing and we're sharing, we're doing a puzzle together, that is a quality opportunity and time for our children and for us, because we can relax in that time. Everybody enjoys the time, that they get to relax and unwind and laugh. And that's the times that we look forward to. Those are the times that we remember really well. And so, if we can incorporate more quality time with our family, that can also help us with our outlook. Additionally, develop good habits. Okay. And when I say good habits, in my work with children, I always would say, is it the best idea to play games, after your parents go to bed and get up and do this? And of course, they would, oh no, I shouldn't be doing that. But sometimes those habits get formed, especially right now. We've been on summer break, and so our children may have developed a lot of habits that perhaps are going to be difficult to break. So right now we can start kind of easing our children back from their technology use, maybe, or get them in a routine again of getting up in the morning to, be productive as well. And for ourselves also, sometimes we fall into those kind of habits. Oh, we stay up later. We eat more junk food. No, we don't need to clean out that room. We'll do it later. And so we're kind of procrastinating things. And, our kids will do the same thing. And if we all do that same kind of pattern, we're all developing that same kind of habit, it can be very, very difficult for us to break. So if we just maybe practice 2 to 3 good habits, they'll build. It'll build on itself, because we will be in that pattern. We'll be in that routine already. Moving along, to brighten your outlook, focus on the things that you can control. So when we talk about what we can control, sometimes we realize there's not a whole lot of things that we can control. And this is what makes it very difficult for individuals dealing with stress, especially with unforeseeable events in the future and, what might happen or what might not happen. We could spend hours of our day devoted on what can I control? What can I fix? And a lot of times we don't have that kind of power. So really focusing on what we can do is beneficial, and it helps our own emotional well-being. We cannot control weather. We cannot control vaccines or when COVID will disappear, but we can control the good food that we provide to our family. We can control, how our time is balanced. We have a lot of control over our own time, and sometimes we don't control it. So we really, if we change the way we think, it does make our mindset different, and it brightens our outlook. Also, reflecting on good deeds. We all do things, and sometimes we don't even look at what we do, but sometimes we're really, trying to help somebody out. We had the hurricane a few weeks ago, and we really just saw an outpouring of community, an outpouring of neighbors trying to help neighbors, move broken trees and so on and so forth. And those are good deeds. And so we can reflect on the time that we've helped somebody. And, that will also help us with our own outlook. And, sometimes we're really hard on ourselves and we need to show a little self-love. And so that's the purpose of these two points. Also, to reduce stress, set priorities, be organized, and if you fail to plan, you can most certainly plan to fail. So when I say set priorities, maybe it's not get everybody's school supplies in one day, because that might be extremely stressful for you, because you may have to go to 7 different stores and you may have to go back because the truck has not arrived, or different situations like that. But if maybe you say, okay, well, Monday I will get Johnny's supplies, Wednesday I'll go back and get little Susie's and Tommy's supplies. Prioritize your time and organize it is a big helper. I know that right now meal preps are really a big industry becoming, where people are starting to make the preparations for the whole week, that just little emphasis on preparation does wonders for individuals. Instead of scrambling around, maybe you oversleep sometimes, the alarm, you have, you know, 8 different alarms in the morning and you oversleep. And then you're thinking, oh my gosh, I didn't make my lunch last night. I didn't pack lunch for the kids, or I didn't prepare this, or, you know, I don't know where my bag is. And that can add to your stress in the mornings. So if you have things prepared the night before, or maybe on a Monday, you know, prepare all the things that you'll need for the week, that's just something small that can reduce your stress. And that will help you out. And again, always, if you fail to plan, you can most certainly plan to fail. And that will also increase your stress. Moving along, for my personal experience, I have always been a very strong advocate for being creative, because creativity does wonders for your mind, your body, your soul. And, you know, children are inherently creative. They can create anything out of anything. You give them a box and that box becomes a fort. Then that box will become an automobile. And then that box will become a NASA ship to take them to the moon. And then later on, it'll become something that the dog will live in. So kids have this innate ability to be just creative with whatever they find. And we lose that sometimes somewhere along the path into adulthood. And we find ourselves being really stressed out. And if you look at children typically are not very stressed out. Of course, you know, they don't have a lot of things on their mind, but they are very creative. And that creativity, I think, helps regulate them and helps them stay balanced. And so we as adults can utilize a lot of expressive arts techniques. So singing. And it doesn't have to be in tune. It doesn't have to be in key. It doesn't have to be even the right words. If you're humming, if you're, you know, just singing, because you are doing something expressive. And we all have those songs, those jams, quote unquote, that really get us pumped. They really get us motivated. They get us to do something. And so even just turning that on and singing along with it can help you in the day. Drawing or doodling, coloring. There is research that has proven that when you draw or doodle or color, it lowers your cortisol response in your body, which a cortisol response, just go through that real quick before we get back to this. Cortisol is a hormone that we have, and it is the stress hormone. And this is a hormone that is not good, because when our bodies are stressed, our bodies will release cortisol. Now, cortisol is the fat hormone, so it will make you gain weight around your midsection. So over time, we know that that is connected to a lot of other health concerns. And so if we can find ways to lower our cortisol response, which drawing, doodling, and all of those expressions, then that benefits our body. So we don't have to do it alone, because I know that, you know, as a parent, we all get bombarded. You know, our kids want a lot of attention from us. And so we can sometimes feel like it's selfish to sit down and draw and color. What I do is I bring my children with me and I say, okay, it's coloring time. We're all going to color together. And so everybody does their own activity. They draw, they color, they use finger paints, whatever it may be. And we're all doing it together. So it becomes like a family activity and we're all relaxing. Then, the last creative. Now, of course, this is not the only thing. I mean, I don't want for anybody to walk away saying, oh, well, you know, I like to do woodwork. And you know, that, well, that's a creative expressive, you know, whittling with, some people like to make little figures out of wood, things of that nature. Some people like to paint, you know, anything where you're being expressive is great for your own emotional well-being. Lastly, I included dancing because sometimes, you know, that's the best way to get a workout in. It's the best way to get our kids involved. You know, there's tons of games that you can play with your children that involve, you know, this movement type activity. So before we go on, let me check back in with Miss Rubio to see if we have any questions in the chat that I need to address.
At this moment, we don't have any questions. However, our audience is providing great ideas as well on how to de-stress. So thank you to the audience for that.
Great, great. Excellent, excellent. So as we continue an emotional wellness discussion here. We want to talk about, you know, connecting with our own spirit can do wonders for our own emotional wellness. So some of the ideas and suggestions are, you know, listening to a faith-based podcast, maybe practice positive self-talk, because we do hear a lot of negativity. And, you know, we have to retrain our brain. We have to retrain how we think, how we process, how we move forward. Because our children are watching. And if we want for them to do these types of things and practice positive self-talk, we also have to do that as well. I would always do an activity with my students when I was a school counselor, and I would always ask them to list the negative things they heard versus the positive. And it was so easy for them to write down the negative things, but it was very difficult for them to write down the positive things. So that's an indication that from a very young age, we really need to start working our children and teaching them and helping them. And if we do it, and we say it to ourselves, you know, I got this, I can do this, this is not going to be that hard, I am going to overcome this, these kinds of messages, our children see that, they will embody them as well. So practice positive self-talk. And again, if you need to write little post-its notes, leave them on your mirror, put them on your phone as a screenshot. You know, there's a variety of ways that you can implement that in your own way. Also praying or meditating, whichever you feel more comfortable doing, and finding a purpose in your life. And that's always, you know, beneficial to understand. You know, I know that sometimes we may think, oh, well, you know, I just have this job, or I just do this, but it can be so much more than that if we really find a way to connect it to the greater good of humanity or to help other people. We have all been impacted by different experiences. And so sometimes just being able to find a way to maybe help somebody else out, using what we've learned in our life to maybe be a mentor or to maybe help children learn to read. Maybe as a child, it was difficult for you to read. And so maybe volunteering to teach others to read, those types of things are things that we can do. We all have a way and a purpose to help others, and that really helps our own. It gives us a sense of purpose. It gives us a sense of well-being. And so that is vital to emotional wellness. So moving along, now we are going to switch gears into self-care, because self-care and stress management are very closely related. And right now in our world, more than ever, we need to have self-care. How do we take care of ourselves? So we're going to go through definitions, some sample plans, some ideas, and then we'll wrap up with some questions. So self-care defined is just activities or practices that we do to reduce our stress levels and to improve our well-being. Self-care is not adding more. It's not an emergency plan, and it is never selfish, okay? And the reason I say an emergency plan for chaos is because in my professional work, I've worked with, you know, many individuals who will say, well, you know, I know my sister's wedding is coming, and, you know, so the night before, I'm gonna go to the spa and I'm gonna just de-stress. And I'm thinking, well, you know, that might help for that one thing, but, you know, over time you could have been, you know, engaging with other things, practicing deep breathing, maybe taking walks, maybe doing other things that can also assist. It's not a one-time event. Okay. We all need self-care, and we need it regularly. We need it regularly. So I include this picture because if you have ever flown, the stewardess on the left in the red suit will come on board, and she'll explain if oxygen were to ever leave the cabin, if there were to be a loss of pressure, these little oxygen devices will fall from the little center console, and you'll need to put it on yourself. And then she advises, put it on yourself first before you put it on anybody else. And so if you look at the picture on the left, there's a father who has his own oxygen mask on, and now he's proceeding to help his child. This is the way it needs to work, okay? We, as parents, as family members, have a lot of individuals who rely on us. Now, if we don't take care of ourselves, there's no way that we can help anybody else. And going back to the example of the airplane, if we have helped seven different people in the airplane put on their oxygen mask, who will help us if we pass out because we don't have enough oxygen? And they're small, they cannot help us. So we always have to make sure that we are helping ourselves first and foremost, and then we proceed to help others. It's not selfish, it's prudent, it's wise, it's smart, because we have to be strong enough to help other people. So that's always something that I always remember about that, because it's very important that we have to take care of ourselves first before we can take care of our children and our families. So what are you doing for your own physical, psychological, emotional, social, spiritual, environmental, and financial well-being? What are you doing? What plans do you have? Everybody needs to have a plan, because if we fail to plan, we can plan to fail. And that little image of the cup, you can never pour from an empty cup. You always have to take care of yourself first. So a self-care plan doesn't have to be elaborate. It doesn't have to be something that is, you know, go and get a $600 gym membership. That's not what I'm saying at all. It's just small things that you can do. However, a self-care plan always has to include healthy boundaries, knowing your threshold, knowing what's the limit for you, and giving yourself breaks. Because a lot of times, again, going back to our culture, we do not stop. We do not take breaks. We want to push, 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 do more, more, more. And that can be very, very detrimental for ourselves and for our own well-being. So again, self-care plans should include 3 to 5 activities that you can do to de-stress. It always should be on your calendar, and you need to make time for it. And in that small little image that's there, you know, there's some self-care activities that you can do today. You can stay hydrated. That's number one. You can schedule me time. You can exercise. You can maybe meditate or pray. And you can get good sleep. Those are just very basic, simple things. But if you think about it in the grand scheme of everything, sometimes we don't even do those things. Sometimes we don't drink enough water. We don't sleep sometimes. You know, we can have, you know, maybe a 4-hour night several days a week of sleep. And we all know that that's not healthy. That's not good. So we have to make time for wellness, otherwise it will not happen. So on the next slide, I just kind of created a sample plan. And this is something that you can create on your own, put it on your refrigerator, put it on your phone, just to have something that you say, okay, no, now it's time for me to listen to my favorite song, or now it's time to make a positive note to myself. And each day there's a different activity. Now I get that some of these activities won't work for some people. For example, the non-coffee people of the world may not enjoy coffee outside. So that can easily be substituted for a cup of tea, maybe, you know, some fresh lemonade, things of that nature. Enjoying a favorite meal. You know, sometimes we don't get to enjoy the meal because we're eating fast. Even sometimes I've noticed that some people complain they don't feel well. And then you ask about, well, what was your eating habit like? Well, I had to eat in like 3 minutes. And so consuming an entire meal in 3 minutes is going to give anybody a stomach ache or a stomach issue. So, you know, just making the time to enjoy and be mindful. So you see, there's just a wide variety of things. And again, this plan has to be tailored to what you like and what you desire to do. Because I can only offer suggestions, but it's always up to the individual to decide what they want to utilize, how they want to do it. So if you are a night owl, obviously waking up to watch the sunrise is not going to work for you. So maybe, you know, incorporating something else, maybe watching the stars instead of waking up to see the sunrise, you know, connecting with nature. And, you know, just utilizing different things that really work for you and help you out. I know that I'm a student. I am also a mom. I am a wife. I am a daughter. I am a full-time counselor. And I also supervise other counselors. So, you know, my plate is full all the time. And so I have to make sure that my self-care plan is in place all the time. So sometimes even saying no to things, going back to our boundaries. I've talked to parents and children and you know, parents will sometimes call and say, you know, it was a really bad weekend. Little Johnny, you know, I had to get after him, I had to ground him, I had to take away things. And so I'll ask, well, tell me more, you know, what exactly is happening or what happened? Well, it's because we had 6 birthday parties on Saturday. And after the third one, he started having a fit and he was mad and, you know, he didn't want to go to the other 3. And I was upset because I said, these are my people from, you know, my family. We have to go. We can't stay home. You know, we got invited. And so I kind of, you know, stop and say, you know, what happened, you know, in that whole scheme of, was little Johnny maybe tired? And, you know, he has a threshold too. Children have thresholds too of what they can take and what they can tolerate. And then once they reach it, we know that they're cranky, they're tired, and then it just throws everything into a tailspin. So if children have thresholds, we as adults also have thresholds. And so sometimes we have to stop ourselves and say, you know what, no, I can't go to 7 birthday parties on a Saturday because I have laundry to do. I have homework projects that I need to help my children with, you know. And of course, these are examples that are pre-social distancing, but, you know, sometimes the concept remains, you know, we can sometimes overwhelm ourselves with our scheduling or volunteer for things. Oh yes, you know, you want beans for 200 people? Sure, I can do that. And then, you know, you're backtracking and thinking, oh no, I'm not going to have enough time to do that. And then kind of this frenzy sets in of how am I going to do that for this friend of mine who's having this birthday party for her daughter. And so, you know, we sometimes do a lot of this to ourselves, and we really have to be careful so that we can take care of ourselves so we can function better, especially in these stressful times that we are in. So we're almost to the end. So most importantly, if you have current mental health needs, please continue your treatment. I know that right now, you know, doctor's offices are, you know, it's very sporadic. It can be very difficult, but please try to maintain whatever mental health needs you have. Please continue to try to keep those met. And, you know, if you are having issues handling stress that are, you know, beyond, you know, your abilities to deal with it, please reach out to your practitioner, to your doctor. That way you can get the appropriate help. We never want to just try to do things on our own if we can. If we need help, we need to reach out. So that last little image, you know, please take care of yourself so that you can take care of others, because we do have a lot of people that depend on us and rely on us. And so these are just, you know, some last little tidbits, some support lines, some helplines. And I love this little image right here. You wouldn't let this happen to your phone, right? We carry around umpteen hundred different devices to charge our phone and to keep it charged. There's this now whole industry with all those little portable chargers that are all available, you know. And there's even chargers in public places, in airports, there and under the seats, there at the mall, you know, because we want to keep our phones charged. But how often are we making room for ourselves to be recharged? Is the question that, you know, I like to think about. How often are we making time for our own well-being so that we stay recharged? Because it is important and it is vital. So that is the conclusion of this presentation. So now we'll turn it over to some Q&A. If we have any questions, Ms. Rubio.
Ms. Sanchez, we do have a question from one of our audience members. The question is, if a student is high school level and mother continues to be overprotective, how can someone help him escape from anxiety and encourage him with his self-esteem?
Okay, if a student is, okay. This is a bit of a challenging question, but I think trying to help the child see their own strengths and trying to build on their own strengths, because sometimes, you know, children feed off of the energy that parents, you know, display in front of them. We model our own behaviors, and sometimes our children mimic our behaviors. You know, it's just, it's common. It's what they know. It's what they see. So I guess as an outsider, really trying to help the child would be try to help build on their strengths, you know, and trying to teach, you know, good self-care and trying to help them understand, you know, we all will have stress or we all will have anxiety. We have to deal with it. We have to, you know, and of course, this would probably require a lot of work with between the parent and the child, and which may not be easy, I'm presuming, from the question. But for sure, we would want to make sure that, you know, we get good conversations going about how we can manage and handle our emotions.
Okay, at this time, we don't have any other questions that I see here. Just a lot of good feedback. And like I said, many of our audience members did provide their own strategies and ideas. So thank you, audience.
Thank you all. I hope that everyone got some nuggets of wisdom from this presentation. You know, please reach out if you ever, you know, have any kind of mental health needs, reach out to your own provider, or, you know, we're willing to help. We want to assist people get connected to the right supports. So, you know, we want to encourage parents to take care of themselves. That way they can also help take care of their children. If there's no other questions, I believe I'll turn it back over to Ms. Cardosa. Are you with us still?
Yeah.
There you are.
Hello. Thank you so much. This was a very informative session. Thank you, Ms. Loretta Sanchez and Ms. Marisa Rubio. Please tune in this afternoon as well. We will have the Spanish session this afternoon. Please reach out to our counseling department if you have any concerns. We will be posting the links. We posted a link as well for our social emotional learning, and we will be posting another link for Alliance Connect, or if you want to reach out to any of our counselors. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.